Recorded Books and RB Digital present The String by Caleb Breakey. Narrated by Jason Culp. 1. The branding iron pulsated reddish-orange in the corner fireplace. It was time. The conductor applied the last bit of cakey white paste to his face and pulled his hood over his eyes. He took a seat in front of a tripod-mounted camera in the center of his basement and pressed play. The woman on the other end of the private feed was probably picking up static this very minute. He held his breath. An icon appeared to show that his audience of one had tuned in.
"Hello, Janet,"
he whispered into the lens. Behind him, firelight cast waves of mango glow onto a crate in which lay Janet's treasure, her companion, her confidant. The pup yawned.
"Hold a moment. Ruby is stirring."
The conductor walked to the crate, unlocked its door, and tousled the dog's ears. Soft as a lamb's they were. The Labrador casually scanned the unfamiliar lair, still disoriented from the muscle relaxants he'd snuck into her food dish. She looked into his eyes with such trust, such innocence. The conductor hooked a retractable leash onto her pink collar and led the delirious pup directly in front of the camera.
"Don't mind her clumsiness. This little jewel has been tripping Nirvana for hours. She was a very hungry girl."
How was Janet doing so far? Tearing up? Feisty little thing was probably cursing him out.
"This is a one-way feed, Janet. Wouldn't want emotion getting the best of us, given your relationship with lovely Ruby."
The conductor sat and crossed his legs.
"Life and death. We think of these as destinations, but they're not. They're not. They're choices. And you have a choice to make. For you, for your sister, and for your stupid dog."
The conductor tossed a leash over a support beam and caught it on its way back down. Then he yanked. Ruby yelped at the pressure and stood on her back legs, whimpering but able to breathe, her putrid dog breath permeating the air.
"Good girl. You were choking, but you altered your position."
The conductor gazed into the camera, letting his eyes linger.
"What a concept."
Still gripping the leash, he walked toward the fireplace and raised his arm to its limit. Ruby was suspended in the air for a moment before the conductor dropped her back to one foot. He pulled the branding iron out of hissing coals and gazed at its glow.
"Animal branding used to be so unassuming. No tattoos, earmarking, RFID tagging. Just stick it in the fire and press it to the flesh."
He turned back to the tripod.
"But I wouldn't last 20 minutes enforcing an iron's will onto livestock. I'm tired just hoisting Ruby."
He leaned forward.
"So, the simple way to do this is the eyeballs."
He let Janet digest his words as he knelt next to Ruby, gripping the iron in one hand while stroking her ears with the other.
"You're one of a kind, Ruby. That blend of serene trust and innocent joy. I wonder if Mama Janet will make sure you stay that way."
The conductor looked at the camera, tilted his head, and flatly said,
"Call 555-3203.
Moments later, his burner phone rang and he answered.
"Hello, Janet."
Tear-filled obscenities shot from Janet's mouth like a cannon, quickly chased by a detailed torture regimen she promised to inflict upon him should he so much as look at Ruby again. A fireball, this one. But then she melted into spasmodic weeping. They always did.
"As I was saying," the conductor said, "it's time for your next assignment."
2. I closed my eyes and pictured the moment when SWAT training would be over and I'd be stepping out of my forerunner at Steph's house.
Neither she nor the girls would come running. We'd only been dating 5 months, after all. But in this vision, they did come running, and I couldn't suppress how that image made me feel. A hand cupped the back of my head.
"That's the spirit, Hossie. Grin like a fool. You got this," said Cody Calkins, who was never short on confidence. "Just know that if you fail, I get Stephanie."
"She'd crush you." Cody dropped his head.
"I know."
The whistle blew. Weighted with a 25-pound vest, I started pumping out chin-ups, muscles tensing, eyes fixed on the evergreens surrounding the SWAT training field. 3 were required. I racked up 23, then sprinted to the sandbag thrust. I pictured the first day Steph had invited me to meet Isabella and Tilly over spaghetti and plastic teacups. It had only been a few months ago, but something special had happened that day.
"Don't leave,"
Isabella, the older of the girls, had said after I'd risen to leave.
"You must eat dessert."
Her smile had nestled in my heart. Steph and her girls were as close to angels as I'd ever met. I couldn't think of anything better than to be a permanent part of their lives.
65,
I said, throwing the bag and hustling toward the gauntlet.
2:12,
SWAT team leader Jeff Carnes said as I sprinted across the finish line. I crouched and concentrated on my breathing, heart slamming against my chest. Salt stung my eyes, but I could still see well enough to notice Mitchell, Dominguez, Adams, and Mathis avoiding eye contact. Competence earned respect. It was as simple and as hard as that. If you could listen to direction, hear some criticism, and make changes to do better the next time, respect slowly built. But outside of Cody, I had a long way to go with my peers. Cody walked over to me, looking like he was already doing the math in his head.
"You just netted 118 and took top spot away from you-know-who, Hossie."
He raised his hands and turned in a slow circle, making eye contact with the other SWAT members.
"What did I say? I said Haas was a Greek god. Did I not say he was a Greek god?"
I'd learned long ago that Cody was going to be Cody, no matter what I said, no matter what anybody said. So I just rolled with it.
"How'd you do?" I said. "If there's a slower version of a Greek god, I'm him."
"How'd we do?" Cody squinted and pursed his lips.
"Breachers took first, assaulters second, and the gas guys got third. So gas guys pay plates, we cover drinks and tip, and breachers eat themselves out of their top spot for free."
He shook his head.
"Next month, assaulters wine and dine like royalty. Book it."
"This the most big boy thing you two do?"
said Mike Mitchell, a SWAT member from the Trenton Police Department. None of the city guys respected non-city SWAT, especially Mitchell. I didn't blame them, not after the way I'd been recruited to SWAT. Cody hit my shoulder, a winsome grin spreading across his face.
"Hear that, Haas? Rhino Butt thinks you're making him look like wrinkles and ear hair to our commanding officers."
I loved Cody for wearing his heart on his sleeve, even liked his quick wit. But to me, words were like money. Save them, invest them, spend them, in that order. Cody spent his words like a slot junkie in Vegas. Mitchell stepped into Cody's space.
"You don't get it. You put in all this energy out here, but the rest of us, the real men, put it into the work. You didn't earn this. You're tour guides."
They stared at each other. "Touch each other and you're both suspended, you know that," I said. Mitchell suddenly lost interest in Cody, instead turning to me.
"But not for you, right? How's that flesh wound from your little operation anyway? You should call CBS, CNN, and Fox. Make sure they do a follow-up."
I declined to respond. Cody leaned close to Mitchell's ear.
"Where were you again while Hossie was heroing it up? Oh, right. Ogling those scared underage dorm girls."
Mitchell kept his eyes on me, but spoke to Cody.
"If your results were as big as your mouth, Calkins, you might have actually done better for yourself than that sorry badge you towed around. unlike Haas here, who needed to be in the right place and right time as a university cop to even be considered for SWAT.
I bent down and tightened my laces. I had no idea silence could be so loud.
Cody shook his head. Say that in a nice dark alley with Haas sometime. See how it goes. Big strong guy like you? I'm sure you'd do fine.
Hey!
Jeff Carnes yelled. Move it!
The entire team jogged to the weight room, torpedoing the turf with spit. 30 minutes into lifting, perspiration forced us to ditch our drenched shirts. I'd need a nose plug to keep working out alongside Cody.
Haas is getting yoked,
Carnes yelled from across the room, gawking at me. I let a smile nudge my lips. That may have been the first compliment I'd heard since the incident. Praise came sparsely to me, a university cop, and Cody, the county sheriff's detective. We were SWAT outsiders, recruited only for our knowledge of Trenton University and the county's back roads. Every other officer on SWAT worked at the Trenton Police Department, watching each other's backs on a daily basis. But Cody and me? At best, we'd skipped in line. At worst, we didn't belong. Tell me if this sounds misogynistic to you, because I don't want it to, I had said sincerely to Stephanie 3 months earlier. I think I understand what women face breaking into traditionally male careers. Steph laughed so hard that she accidentally woke Isabella and Tilly. That's the cutest thing I've ever heard you say, she'd said through a snort. A buzzer sounded. Workouts were over, and target practice commenced. We peppered targets for 45 minutes. Each punctured bullseye reminded me that I fervidly wanted to stop evil at a job that may never face it. I collected my riddled sheet and studied it, paper crinkling in my hands. Kill shot, flesh wound, kill shot, flesh, kill shot. I had work to do.
Not bad, Mitchell hollered over to me. Think those dorm girls who saved your sorry butt could do better?
A few SWAT guys laughed. Cody shot Mitchell a glare.
Wrap it up, Carnes said.
Cody and I and the rest of SWAT headed back to the station, took off our vests, then sat for a presentation focused on floor science, in which a professor taught how eyesight and flinch responses work, such as how fast a human can turn around and squeeze off 3 rounds as opposed to just firing from the hip. Mitchell craned his neck toward Clint Hopkins, another SWAT member from the Trenton Police Department.
Makes you wonder how many rounds you can get off while high.
This time I tensed up. Mitchell had been in rare form all day. I turned to look him in the eyes, wanting so badly to drop him and make him feel what I was capable of. But my anger quickly transformed to alarm. A fist was blurring past my eyes and connected directly with Mitchell's forehead, producing a hearty smack. I caught Cody on his follow-through and immediately shoved him against the wall. Adams, Dominguez, and Mathis shouted and closed in around us, ready to break things up. Hopkins and a few other SWAT members picked up Mitchell, who got to his feet and rubbed his mouth.
Feel good, Hawkins?
Mitchell spit some blood.
Enjoy vacation.
Carnes burst into the commotion like a wrecking ball of profanity and popping veins. He told Mitchell and Cody to get lost and demanded everyone present to email him reports. Training was officially over. I followed Cody as he headed for his vehicle. He'd get suspended for that punch. Hey, Muhammad Ali, I said. He turned around. Was that like a butterfly or a bee? Feel good?
Better than you can imagine.
I asked a question I knew the answer to.
Why?
Cody flicked his hand a couple of times, releasing some of the throbbing he had to be feeling.
You'd already done it in your head, so I figured I'd provide the visual. More exciting, you know?
I had it under control.
You didn't have to.
Yeah, I did.
His voice had lost that normal Cody charm.
When your friend gets knocked down, you help him up, or punch the guy who started it.
Not if it means a suspension.
I'm tired of seeing Mitchell and the rest of these clowns push you around. You're better than all of them, and you know it. We're in the business of justice, Haas. You're not practicing it.
There was much I wanted to say, but knew I couldn't go that route, so I practiced silence and let his words sink in. I nodded. Thanks, really.
Cody switched the conversation's direction. How's the university treating you?
Let's just say I like today, I said. Definitely beats the monotony of patrol.
You mean beat slapping students with urinating in public citations?
Pretty much.
What does Steph think of SWAT?
She likes that I'm better trained, and she's excited for what it might lead to.
Lead to? You applying?
I could only wish that were true, but it would be a move I'd ultimately regret. Climbing the ladder always led to the rest of your life, friends, family, home, spiraling into chaos. Easy as a bachelor, torture as a man in love. Sure, it was nice entertaining Stephanie's encouragement about career advancement, but that's all it was, entertaining. I even had to be careful with that because the temptation was so great. We stopped at our vehicles, me by my university police-issued 4Runner, and Cody by his Camaro. A few of our colleagues' cars whooshed out of the parking lot. I leaned against my door. Next thing circled on my calendar is grilling for students off my tailgate. I like that. I nodded at the training facility and chose my words carefully. But this training isn't helping me at the university. Cody popped his trunk and grabbed 2 water bottles from the back. He handed one to me.
I get it.
His breath poofed in front of him a little in the cold evening.
You want some whack job to go on a gun rage, huh?
He winked. I don't envy danger, but people are doing jacked up stuff every day, and I can't do a thing about it. It felt good to vent to Cody, even if he had no clue what I was really saying, what had actually happened with my career. I feel like I'm trained to slay Goliaths at a job where bad guys are 3 feet tall. Cody spit some of his water.
Well, next time I'm wrestling a heroin addict with needles sticking out of his arms, I'll give you a shout, David.
I smiled, we tapped fists, then drove our separate ways. I just wasn't as needed at Trenton University as I would be elsewhere. But I couldn't take a job away from Steph and the girls, not without them coming with me. And I couldn't be sure she was ready for that, for marriage. The M word wasn't optional with Steph, but essential. She wasn't afraid of commitment and didn't need to keep her options open. I liked that about her. But marriage would be complicated for Steph because the first man she'd made vows to, Declan, turned out to be nothing short of a high-functioning sociopath. After marrying right out of high school, getting Steph pregnant, and creating a rich lifestyle for her and the girls, he'd cheated on her. Not with one woman, but with a different woman every week. A tapestry of lies and manipulation so ugly that the portrait would hang itself. Declan had tried to take everything in the divorce, but thankfully the judge saw through his smoke. So the house, and much more importantly, the girls, went to Stephanie. He tried inching his way back into their lives after that, creating a new life only a few hours away in Seattle and stopping by to surprise the kids on holidays. But I'd helped Steph put an end to those visits and get the court orders needed that would keep Declan where he belonged, out of their lives for as many days of the year as possible. Steph had risen to the challenge of single parenting, found Jesus at a warehouse church where the pastors wore jeans, and somehow kept up her jovial personality through the pain. I dialed her number.
Hey, Robo, she answered. How'd Call of Duty go?
I smiled. The controller ran out of battery, so I'm calling you.
Well, I have 2 very excited girls over here who can't stop talking about some fort they plan to build with you.
Whoops, I'd forgotten about that promise.
It's going to be a castle with a moat to keep that stray cat out, if I'm remembering right.
Poor Puddles, she said.
Can I bring anything other than the veggies?
Steph scoffed. Ugh, yeah. Chocolate. And soda. There also happens to be a girl here who may or may not wear a pink bow every day of her life and hasn't stopped talking about the flowers you brought her last week, so just saying. Points to be had.
Noted. And what about Tilly?
I wasn't going to say anything, but now that you ask, no more lollipops for her. I'm done slathering her hair with peanut butter and coconut oil, all because she insists on sleeping with sticky candy.
I'll make the switch to Starbursts, I grinned.
And would the lady of the house care for wine?
Mr. Haas, are you trying to romance me?
It's kind of my thing.
Then wine you shall bring.
Only if you quit leaving your doors unlocked.
Old habits die hard, she said in her cute tail-between-the-legs voice.
I kinda like you, I said. I kinda like you, too.
We hung up, and I felt a familiar swirl deep in my chest. I wanted to be there for Steph and the girls. What that might mean for my long-term career, I wasn't ready to think about. Not yet. Steph needed stability. The pain she'd faced was more than any person should carry. I wasn't about to add to it. Right now, I needed to find contentment in university work and just be a rock for her. Tomorrow, I would barbecue for new students at the orientation fair, and that was just fine. Others could protect the world from evil for now.
3. Friday, 8 p.m. Stars flickered above as Officer Mike Mitchell pulled into the wide, gravelly driveway. He loved Friday nights because it meant playing poker and making money. Both were guaranteed after he and his TPD colleagues wrapped up for the night and headed over to Officer Clint Hopkins's pad. Hopkins had a family, but he'd always kept one foot in the bachelor life, starting with an enormous shop where he did bodywork on cars and trucks. He'd collected pinball and slot machines, a jukebox, air hockey tables, pool tables, dartboards. As magical as this part of the man cave was, it merely served as the appetizer for what brought Mitchell and his colleagues here weekly. The real banquet sat four steps up to another level of the pad, which was surrounded by flat screens, an industrial-sized vent for their cigar smoke, and a fully stocked minibar that glistened under black lights. Mitchell noticed the lack of noise and figured none of the boys had surpassed three drinks yet, two if it were Adams. They were probably sitting around the big, felted poker table, puffing cigars as they waited for him. But had someone muted the TVs? There were almost no sounds as he walked in. All he could hear was a tapping sound on a counter, like a poker chip doubling as a fidget toy.
Why isn't the game on? Bunch of fair-weather amateurs, Mitchell muttered, stepping onto the landing.
He paused, taking in the scene, and wanted to reach for his weapon, but realized it was too late. A man wearing a fancy hat and the colorless makeup of a clown stood before him. Dark circles around his eyes and mouth sprouted tiny black threads that spread all over his plaster-white skin. He was clutching two pistols equipped with silencers. One was aimed at Mitchell, while the other dangled loosely in the intruder's hand, tap, tap, tapping ever so gently against the poker table.
It's about time,
the stranger said in an octave somewhere between a tenor and a soprano.
Been trying to convince your friends I'm a worthy opponent. I can play, raise, bluff. But they all tell me the same thing. Mitchell's the best. You've got to play Mitchell. He's the real player.
The clown shook his head and grinned.
So, Mitchell, glad you're here. Take a seat.
He aimed his loose gun at the middle of the table, where all of Mitchell's colleagues' weapons rested.
Leave your manhood there.
Mitchell made eye contact in rapid succession with his fellow officers, each of whom was highly trained in combat. Not a hint that anyone had a plan. Quite the opposite. Their enlarged pupils and ashen skin were telltale signs. They were in shock.
How had they given up their firearms? And where was Mathis?
He set his gun on the table with the others. That's when he noticed the feet sprawled from behind the poker table, a pool of red still growing. He jutted his chin forward for a clearer view, trembling.
What did you do?
He whispered.
What did I do?
The clown scoffed.
Why'd you show up late to game night, Mitch? All the juiciest stories cascade like vomit the first 5 minutes of the party. Everyone knows this. Come, take a look.
Mitchell stepped closer, not once taking his eyes off the psycho until he had a clear view of Mathis. Three bullets had pierced his friend's chest, his eyes still wide with disbelief.
Today just wasn't his lady luck,
the clown said. Mitchell clenched his shaking hands into fists.
Who are you?
But the clown continued like he hadn't heard him.
Who would have thought that marriage could save anyone?
He hunched his shoulders.
But here we are, your colleague kissing the afterlife, all because he didn't have someone to go home to tonight. I can be merciful like that. See?
The clown pointed at Mitchell.
Yet here's the twist, Mitch. Those three bullets, they're from Larry's, Curly's, and Moe's chambers.
He glanced at Hopkins, Adams, and Dominguez.
And the fourth,
the clown snatched up Mitchell's gun,
is from yours.
He fired point blank into Mathis's forehead. Mitchell's stomach lurched. He pressed his lips together and looked away along with his colleagues. What had they done to deserve this? What was this lunatic's game? What was he going to do to the rest of them? The clown shoved the gun into the back of his pants, then picked up a duffel bag on the floor beside him.
Poker's a wonderful game. Texas Hold'em, a national treasure. But the alpha competitiveness of five hot-headed colleagues always flinging around their egos, well, it was bound to blow amid all the high stakes bidding, bluffing, and booze. How four of Trenton's finest could kill a friend in cold blood over a few $100 will keep the regional papers busy for weeks. Hungry to eat up, you white, balding, power-hungry, and crooked cops.
A frame job. This clown was devising a plot to put them all behind bars.
You're sick.
The clown looked at Mitchell with sympathy.
No, Mitch.
He glanced at the corpse.
Not I, but you.
He began placing items into his bag, a clattering assortment of their guns, liquor bottles, glasses, chips, cigars.
All the evidence points to locking you away. The other juicy parts, like your affairs,
he pointed at Mitchell and Hopkins,
those are just bonus details to make sure conjugal visits are out of the question.
Mitchell couldn't keep up with the horrific thoughts racing through his mind. His career would be gone. His wife and kids gone. Freedom gone. All because of a whack job in a Halloween costume?
What do you want?
You catch on fast, you officer SWAT team professional you. One moment you're ready to unwind and let all that stress melt away. Then the next you're making a deal with the devil, yes? That is the power of the will.
The clown waved his hands slowly, as if casting a different future.
Shame your friend was having such horrible thoughts, journaling his hatred for himself and his addictions. It would appear Mathis could no longer take the darkness, so he decided to leave this note and nothing else.
He held up a typed letter.
The only problem, it seems, is where did he go to end it? Where did he go so that no one would ever find him?
The clown flipped the duffel bag over his head and onto his shoulder.
Follow me, gentlemen, and grab Mr. Mathis. He'll be my guest of honor until our business is finished.
What business? Mitchell asked.
The clown peered over his shoulder coldly, barely making eye contact.
Call it the string.
4. Saturday, 3:30 p.m.
You know you're ruining my life, right?
The shirtless student said, running his hands through thick, dark hair. I hated doing this in front of such a large audience, many of them freshmen and their parents, but the university didn't tolerate drinking in public, and university police needed to be extra vigilant on days like today. The opening round of the NCAA Division I men's basketball tournament was no small event. The country would be watching. Thankfully, most of the folks hanging around the shirtless student and me were conversing through shouting and couldn't hear a peep over the band's attempt at music. I pulled up the student's identification card on my phone, then cross-referenced it with the rap sheet app used by the Trenton Police Department. David P. Kilpatrick, 6'1", 150 pounds, an organ donor, never an offender. What's your major? I said. That seemed to calm him a bit.
Double major, but med student.
I raised my brows.
What?
He said. A bit unprofessional for your aspirations, wouldn't you say? David simply looked at his feet. His only clothes were light blue jeans rolled halfway to his knees and forest green boxers, of which 5 inches showed.
You're driving me away from this town, he said, shaking his head.
I didn't owe David a response, especially one steeped in guilt, but silence created a deeper rift between university police and students, a gap I'd worked hard to fill with big smiles and barbecues.
Dude, you should know better. You can't be drinking in public. And what's with the gym bob fashion and no shirt? They say it might snow tonight.
Tears filled David's eyes. He rubbed his face.
I was just enjoying the sun. My parents.
He started sobbing. I scrunched my brows. I knew what manipulation felt like, and this wasn't it. David was grieving. I put my hand on his shoulder. What about your parents? He didn't respond. Listen, I'm citing you at the minimum. Mistakes happen, and a line on your file won't dictate your future. David looked up, but not at me. Something over my shoulder had snatched his attention. I turned my head.
This isn't who I am,
David blurted out, shaking his head.
These aren't the choices I make.
I stared at him, could feel the load of shame weighing him down. He broke eye contact and shoved his hands in his pockets. You gonna be okay? I said. David glanced past me again. What's so distracting? He backed up a couple of steps, shrugged, and walked away. Heavy. The word throbbed in her mind. Heavy, like being smothered with a wool blanket, breath getting hotter and hotter. Heavy, like stones in place of high heels and chains in place of hair. Jaw clenched, Janet Blevins approached the officer's vehicle, which was parked along the edge of the new student orientation fair. Every brick her heels touched, each person she brushed shoulders with, even the air she breathed, felt like invisible cement seeping into her body and hardening in her bones. Somewhere in the boisterous assembly, a man with a sick intent stood watching her this very moment. But nobody knew her danger. No one could ever know if she wanted to keep her sisters safe. And even that was probably a bald-faced lie to ensure Janet's compliance with the conductor's bidding. But it was working. She glanced at the many faces in the crowd, none of whom seemed to know she existed. How could so much happiness be present in her nightmare? Couldn't they see she needed help? Maybe if she just looked at someone with her eyes shifted just so, they'd understand the chaos inside of her. They'd see that her every move was in direct opposition to her own will and was, in fact, controlled by another's. Janet closed her eyes. Her only hope was to outlast the conductor, completing each task until he stopped demanding and released everyone from the string. She needed to stay strong and finish the assignment. He'd said she was almost finished. She could only hope he was telling the truth, and that his endgame was money or something else material instead of straight terrorism, straight evil for the sake of a game.
Janet looked at the package in her hands and felt her stomach churn. A group of students had chosen to chat right next to the officer's vehicle. She grabbed her cell and faked a text as a tangy waft of barbecue filled her nose. Glancing up, she saw a cooler full of ice and soda sticking out from behind the Forerunner. Now she understood. This vehicle belonged to the officer who grilled for students on orientation day. Haas, she believed his name was. She'd seen a photo in the student newspaper several months ago of him barbecuing and connecting with students, remembered admiring that. And now, she was going to wreck his life. Janet circled the vehicle in one big loop, passing mobs of students, parents, and volunteers, positioning herself so that only one of four nearby students would have a clear view of her as she approached the tailgate. Thankfully, the lone student who'd be able to identify her kept smiling at his phone. She leaned around the side of the tailgate, spotted Officer Haas's university-issued cap lying there, and slipped the package under it. Every part of her was screaming to look at the student one last time to know if he'd be able to identify her. But the deed was done. What happened from this point on would materialize, no matter what. What she needed was to walk away as fast as possible.
Hey, Miss Blevins!
Jimmy from janitorial. So sweet, but so loud.
Good to see you, Jimmy, Janet said, keeping her voice low.
Jimmy stretched his arms wide and nodded continuously with that infectious grin, eyes squinted. He'd started about a year ago through a local agency that placed adults with special needs into various places of work.
New students are the best, Miss Blevins, the best. Have you tried Mr. Haas's tish kebab? It's the best. Want to get one?
Janet put one hand on Jimmy's shoulder, perhaps too quickly. He looked at her hand, still smiling but confused. Her heart hurt. She couldn't push him away like this. She'd worked so hard to befriend him and get him to open up.
Oh, there's nothing I'd rather do than get a kebab with you, Jimmy. But I'm supposed to call someone in a minute. Paper football tomorrow?
His grin returned. I'll be practicing and getting really good for when the games start.
She tucked her chin.
Super Bowl or bust?
Super Bowl or bust?
Janet made her way to the fountain, not once looking back at the students. With Jimmy's voice, she could only imagine how many glances she'd received. But it was out of her hands. She'd finished the assignment, hopefully her last. Heart racing, she pulled out her phone.
I did it. Leave my sister alone.
She released the breath she didn't know she'd been holding. Lucy was safe. For now. She snuck one last glimpse of Haas in his last few moments of peace and normalcy.
I'm sorry, she whispered.
Standing on the sky bridge connecting the gymnasium and amphitheater, the conductor slipped on his noise-canceling headphones and tapped play on his phone. Waves of binaural beats flowed into his ears and down to his cheekbones. Gentle numbing vibrated through his core and wrapped around his very heart, pumping it full of electrical current. He slid his hand into his pocket, brushing the detonator. The conductor's gaze panned to two people in the crowd already playing vital roles in his string. The phone in his pocket buzzed.
I did it. Leave my sister alone.
Speak of the devil. He tapped a reply.
She looks more stunning than ever. Doesn't need the wig. P.S. You're glowing today.
The conductor watched as Janet received the texts and stared at her phone. She glanced at the fair's various attractions, looking like the poster child of spontaneous combustion. Then her shoulders relaxed, likely not wanting to give him the satisfaction. Smart girl. Janet had covertly dropped the package in the back of the police Forerunner that belonged to the newest knot in the string, the only one who truly intrigued him.
Markus Haas. Hands suddenly reached around and covered the conductor's eyes. He switched off his headphones and turned around to find Rosetta.
"Liking the view?" she asked. "You can see everything from up here. So colorful."
He smiled.
"I want shish kebabs and soda."
She placed her hands on her hips and squinted as if thinking hard.
"Why are you all grumps?"
He shrugged.
"Not enough sleep." "So we'll get you a coffee."
She put both hands on his shoulders and leaned back to look through the sky bridge's glass roof.
"And I will require this for the big game tonight."
She swiped the bill off his head and placed it over her dark curls. The conductor snatched it back. Rosetta giggled.
"Whoa, someone's touchy."
Head down, he positioned the cap just so.
"I prefer the cap."
Rosetta shrugged.
"Whatever you say, Captain Longface."
She laughed and tugged his sleeve.
"Let's go scope out where ESPN is setting up so I can get on camera."
Rosetta, sweet and without a clue. Taking her by the arm, the conductor stole one last glance out the skybridge windows and spotted Haas sliding into his forerunner, package in hand. The conductor slid his hand into his pocket. The first surprise would be in Haas's grasp soon. The second had been under his tailgate all day.
"I walked to my forerunner and exchanged my pen and pad of paper for my steel spatula. The students I'd left upon spotting David were still clustered near my tailgate. I banged the flipper against the grill. All right, my friends, I apologize for the delay. Give me a couple minutes." I clicked on the burner and cocked my head. A gift-wrapped box about the size of a hardcover book sat under my hat. Had that been there the whole day? I grabbed the shiny package, walked around to the cab, and climbed in, leaving the door open to stretch my legs. I unwrapped the box to find a computer tablet and a fancy note touched with perfume. The calligraphy read, "To the man I love." Adrenaline burst in my mind, and my mouth opened slightly. I wanted to say something, but my breath refused. Had Steph really written love? I'd refrained from saying the word yet in our relationship, knowing how much the sentiment meant to her and how betrayed she'd been by it in the past. I grinned, and a small laugh sneaked out as I realized how much the word meant to me now. Steph loved me. I'd been patient these past few months, giving her and the girls space. They'd gone through so much heartache. That she was the one stepping out on a limb felt strange. What had made her take this leap? And why now, like this? I looked around, but there was no sign of her. Tiny pinpricks flowed through me as I activated the tablet. I didn't even know Steph owned a tablet. A simple black screen with a play icon appeared. I tapped it, and a slideshow started. Syrupy music filled the forerunner as images populated the tablet from offbeat angles, most likely recorded on Stephanie's phone. Steph dancing and laughing with Isabella in the kitchen, Tilly tapping away on the lens as if playing a game. The three of them squished together, taking selfies in bed. Next came a video of Steph and the girls outside playing in the sprinkler. The angle was odd, though, as if someone was filming them from across the street in the overgrowth. Then came a shot of Steph doing dishes in front of the kitchen window, a pensive look on her face. Another of Steph in nothing but a towel in her bathroom, tapping away at one last text before getting in the shower. My stomach twisted. Steph didn't do this. Who was filming the girls? The screen went dark. I reached for my phone to call Steph, but the tablet came to life again. I saw a dark room, brightened only by the flickering light of old-fashioned lanterns. Glimmers of antique bookshelves and a single stool flickered in and out of focus. A blurred object came into view, and a man sat down in front of the camera. A fancy dark hat overshadowed his face, which resembled a scarred-up Marilyn Manson. Black and white makeup caked his skin so thickly that not one inch of his flesh was visible. His eyes were deeply set under a large, dark hood.
"Sorry about that,"
the white-faced demon said, his voice surprisingly high.
"I have a flair for the theatrical. Your girls are lovely, they really are, but you know that. You know everything there is to know about them, you protective stallion."
I closed the forerunner's door, probably too hard, and furrowed my eyebrows. The man, who sounded like a woman, smiled and leaned back, folding his hands, which were just as white and made up as his face.
"I'm going to make this short, because editing these videos can be a real shard of glass to the eyeballs. You are now a member of the string, Markus."
Unnerving anticipation filled the man's eyes.
"What is the string, you wonder? Think of the string as one long sheet of music, with notes of all shapes and sizes, tones and pitches. You're a note. And judging from what I see, shaved head, muscular, someone who pushes tractor tires just for exercise, I'd say you're of the bass variety."
He pointed at the camera.
"But don't pass judgment against the tenors of the world just because you swing lower than the rest of us."
My face contorted. Who in the world was this lunatic? How did he know my routine? And why had he filmed the girls? The man tilted his chin up like a waiter at a 5-star restaurant.
"I am your conductor, and that's what you will call me."
I grabbed my cell. Wasn't going to put up with this any longer.
"Now, before you do something stupid like call the chief or your girl, Steph, you should know that doing so will hurt someone very close to you. Yes, very close."
He laughed. I put my phone down. Was this guy serious?
"See? Isn't it spectacular? I lift my baton and the string goes up. I dip it, the string goes low."
"Who are you?" I muttered, taking a quick peek out the windshield. Nothing unusual. Same scene, same loud music. The conductor sat upright.
"It all comes down to rules. Rules rule the world," Daddy used to say, that sick old man. "So here are the rules of the string."
He held up a finger.
"Rule one, each person gets a positive and negative reason to play their part. Your positive is simple. I know how badly you want out of this bottom-rung position. Trenton University Police, TUP." "Really? You were meant for better acronyms than TUP." "I will make that happen, and you'll be smiling the way you do grilling for students."
He winked.
"Yes, this might be recorded, but I can see you. I can always see you."
I looked at the rearview mirror, then out both side windows. Just students, their family members, a couple of early bird basketball fans, and some faculty. This conductor could be any one of them. Or completely bluffing. I put one hand on my leg, focused on my breathing. What could I do? What should I do?
"So, the negative. Don't do what I say, and something horrible is going to happen to you. That wouldn't be fair to your lady, Steph, or those two chickpeas, now would it? No, they've already grieved enough."
How do you know so much about their lives? Stephanie needed to know and to protect the girls. The conductor got up from his chair and disappeared. 5 seconds later, he returned holding a male ventriloquist doll.
"My mother gave me this doll years ago. The thing haunted me from the corner of my bedroom. Don't know why I never moved it off its chair. That's what I call it. It. I thought if I ever named it, then it would come alive and stab me while I slept."
He sat the doll on his lap and smiled, as if ready to tell it a story.
"But today, I'm finally deciding to name it. Markus. It's a solid name. But see, now that I've named the doll, I don't dare fall asleep."
The conductor stared at the camera, eyes narrowed.
"And I don't sleep, Markus."
He glanced at the doll.
"So, If you come for me, I'll be waiting under the sheets with a sharp surprise. I know I come across as all cozy bear, but Hasi, to borrow your cute nickname, don't test me.
He leaned forward and whispered,
I do terrible things.
He tossed the doll away. I clenched my fists. I was going to crush his skull.
So, that's rule one. Rule two, dictator decision, the conductor said. But I'm not the dictator. You are. You have the power to destroy not only your own life, but the lives of every knot in the string. Reminds me of my first solo. I played and sang with all my heart, see, and brought down the house in beautiful fashion. Everyone succeeded because I succeeded.
The conductor rubbed his temples.
Oh, but if I had frozen, if I had failed, if I had so much as kissed off one note, every last person on stage would have suffered. We'd have turned beauty into a mockery.
The conductor dipped his fingertips toward the camera.
You are in the spotlight, Markus, standing in heaven's pinprick, and I've given you your cue. All around you stand your fellow musicians, wondering if you'll finish the night with mastery or doom them to despair.
He held his hands out as if weighing options on a scale.
Do you follow the baton the way they have, or walk off stage to their pain and destruction? What are you going to do, Markus?
Stick a taser down his throat. That's what I was going to do. How long was he going to go on for? I eyed my phone a third time. My brain said this was just a twisted, elaborate prank. But it was too elaborate, too direct.
If you don't play your part, the conductor said, tilting his head down and his eyes up, you're going to do far worse things to far more people, and they're all going to know you did it to them. And when a knot breaks the string, knots get broken.
A student approached the driver's side window, asking if more shish kebabs were on the way. I put a finger to my ear, acting as if I were talking via Bluetooth and couldn't get away. The student gave me a thumbs up and walked away. I looked back at the tablet.
Now, finally, rule number three, your duty, the action you must take. It's my favorite part. Care to guess why? It's that moment your will, which has been your protector, friend, and warrior for your whole life, finally drops its guard, then waves mine through. You're going to...
I clicked the tablet's power button and tossed it into the back, called Stephanie. The phone rang three times and then was picked up.
Big mistake, the conductor answered.
Just then, something outside of the forerunner exploded and my head slammed against something hard. Day turned to night, though I never remembered closing my eyes. 5. Saturday, 3:58 p.m. The thunderous burst silenced the crowd and band. Janet, who'd just stepped onto the skybridge to observe...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.